Good morning, and welcome to the Lord's house on this beautiful fall morning. We're glad that you are with us as we celebrate our 149th communion. We're having communion this morning, but homecoming service, and we're glad for those of you who are here with us in person. I know many are still worshiping with us via the web stream, and we ask God's blessings to be upon you all as well. I don't have a tremendous amount of information to share with you that I have not put on the phone tree this past week, but please be mindful of just a couple of things as we look into this week. Tomorrow night, we have our Board of Deacons meeting that will be taking place. Don, are we still going to be in Heritage Hall, or are we going to be back in the Heritage Hall for that? That'll be at 7 o'clock. And also this week we have our adult Bible study time that is in person and also live streamed here in the sanctuary beginning at 10 o'clock. And we will be looking at chapter 18 of Matthew this week. And one final thing If you have your communion elements, hopefully you picked up one of these as you arrived this morning, go ahead now as we're beginning the service and start separating the plastic and the foil. Don't do what I did a few weeks ago when we were having this. I could not get the wafer to open to save my life, so please go ahead and just a heads up, because it can be a little bit tricky there, and we will share in that part of our service here in just a few moments. Marcy has several things that she would like to share, so I'm going to turn that over to her.
Okay. First, he did not announce that we are having our middle schoolers and high schoolers are also meeting on Wednesday night from 6:30 to 7:30. We are excited as that has continued to grow. We are meeting in Heritage Hall to allow for ample social distancing. And so if you have middle schoolers or high schoolers or know of middle schoolers or high schoolers who would like to join us, please let them know about that. And then, of course, we will be having junior church and children's church today. So that's for the preschoolers through fifth graders. And we will be leaving, sorry, David, but right before the sermon. We know you're entertaining, but, you know, it might be a bit much for them to stay still. So those are the opportunities that we are offering right now for our children and youth. Also, as you exit the worship service today, we have in this hallway and into the conference room on display some of the items for our October raffle. Most of you are familiar with our October raffle. It has a calendar full of opportunities, chances to win items for every day in October. Some of the items are already on display. There are calendars available at the end in the conference room where you place your money and you place your tickets after you have filled them out. And so we have very, very good opportunities, things on the calendar this year, and we are excited for those things that have been donated and grateful for them. So please be sure to look at those opportunities, and if you did not come prepared today to fill out tickets, please come back next week. And for those who are viewing online, if you want to send your money to the church, or we will make sure that we fill out the tickets for you. Also, shortly, we haven't exactly set a date, we will be having a yard sale. We have been accumulating things for a year and a half, and we have been blessed to have basically have households worth of stuff that has been donated. So if anyone else has some yard sale stuff that they would like to donate to us, now is the time so that we can go ahead and get that prepared. And we will be giving church members the opportunity to peruse the yard sale stuff first, because it's so much that most of it will be inside first, and then the furniture and big items will be outside. So if you have anything else to donate, please go ahead and do so now. And we're so grateful for everything that has been donated. We think it's going to be a great fundraiser for our youth. I think that's all that we have going on. General board meeting on Tuesday, and that will be in Heritage Hall at 7 p.m. Now let us prepare our hearts for worship. Please stand and join us in the responsive call to worship. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever.
Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable.
One generation shall laud your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts.
On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works, I will meditate.
The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness.
Reverend Dr. D. Wayne Eakes, would you offer our prayer of invocation?
Let us pray. Lord, truly we lift our hearts in praise and extol your name and your greatness and your goodness to us. Bless this, your assembled people, with your presence and with our awareness that you are with us and within us and work through us. Now, Lord, may this service be a glory to your name. Praise and honor go to you through Christ our Lord, in whom we pray and trust. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Our hymn of celebration is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Gospel lesson this morning comes from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. Matthew 20, 1 through 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received their daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God.
As we go to our Heavenly Father in prayer this morning, I draw your attention to the back portion of your bulletin. There at the bottom, you'll find those within our church family in need of prayer during these days. And certainly we want to remember those in our extended community as well. As we think about those who have been hospitalized this week, please remember Don Godwin as he's recuperating from his shoulder surgery that took place successfully on Thursday. Also, we want to remember Billy Watson as he continues his recovery from the leg blockage surgery that they did at Duke earlier in the week. And also, we want to remember Rick Parker as he's continuing his hospitalization as a result of pneumonia, but he has been improving the last couple of days, and there is the possibility that he'll be able to return home sometime today. We also want to lift up, the prayer list says, Miss Barbara Lancaster at Kitty Askins, but that is now the family of. That visitation is this afternoon, and the funeral service will be coming up this Tuesday. What other names, what other needs are close to your heart this morning?
Kelly Lynn Williams,
the mother of Lynn Williams. Ashley?
Kristen Lamb.
Okay. Others. Perhaps by uplifted hand. God sees each and every heart. God understands the depths of our needs. Would you bow with me for a time of prayer? Lord, it is such a challenging passage. It seems so unfair. The first being last and the last being first. But Lord, that's what your kingdom does. It shakes up our normal expectations. It squeezes our comfort zone. Because, Lord, we look at our lives and we think how long we have been faithful and all of the things that we have been able to accomplish for your kingdom. And then we see others who join the cause a little bit later in life, and to know that you still value their efforts the same as those who have spent a lifetime. We just shake our heads. We shrug our shoulders. But, Lord, that's how grace works. Grace is beyond anything our mortal minds can fathom. But Lord, we know that that is exactly what you give. And we know that our world needs a great touch of that for the living of these days, with so much brokenness, so much strife, so much physical pain and suffering. We look around us and sometimes it feels overwhelming when we think about who we are as your people living in times such as these. But Lord, you have called us to be faithful regardless of the circumstances, to live into our calling to be your representatives. Lord, we know it's a tremendous challenge, but we do not go at it alone. We knew that we go with your strength. We know that you fill us with your presence through your Spirit, that you surround us, that you go before us preparing the way. Lord, enable us through obedience, through sacrifice, to be willing to follow you wherever you may take us. Lord, we know this journey is going to be challenging, but Lord, it's a part of our calling to take up our cross daily and to follow you into the unknown. Lord, as we assemble today, we say thank you for your goodness, your love, your mercy, which is new each and every day. We can all look back at times and places in our own journey of faith and bear witness to where you have been so good and faithful to us, providing us with peace, hope, and comfort to see us through life's challenges. Lord, it's with confidence that we come before your throne of grace today, lifting up the names of those who have been mentioned verbally, those printed week by week on our prayer list, and those represented through a number of uplifted hands. Whether it be for those who are hospitalized, those who are recovering from surgeries, those who have doctor's appointments or treatments on the horizon, those who are still trying to ponder the nature of news that they've received that was not so favorable, families who are grieving the passing of loved ones. The hurts are many, but we know that you are a God for all seasons of life, and there is nothing impossible for you. There is nothing we cannot bring into your presence, because we know that you care for us and love us, and nothing is too big or small for your provision. Lord, touch these needs. Be with these names, the families they represent, the caretakers, the medical staff who are working closely. Lord, help them to realize that they are not alone, and help us as your church to be the presence of Christ to those who are going through personal struggles. Now, Lord, continue to be with us in this season of worship and equip us, Father, as we seek to go back out into the world to be your hands and feet in the mission field around us. This prayer we lift up in your Son's precious and holy name.
Thank you.
Always a special time when we can celebrate the lives of the saints, to remember those men and women who've already gone on to their eternal reward, and we're grateful to have Mrs. K. Brown to lead us in that portion of our worship service as we recall the lives of these men and women who've gone to be with the Lord since our time of homecoming 1 year ago.
Good morning. It is always humbling, but always an honor to share in this part of the service, because we do take the opportunity not to list names only, but to remember the heart and the soul that this life represented here on earth. As I was preparing this, and as I talked to people who have lost loved ones, two words tend to be repeated in some semblance or another, and those are loss and gain. So today, let's consider what is lost, but let us be thankful and praise what has been gained. So we're here to honor those saints that have left this earthly existence and have stepped over into the excellence of heaven. 2 Corinthians 5, 6 through 8. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in this body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. And echo in the words of Paul in Philippians 1:21 when he says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." So today, let us look at this in two ways. Let us look at what we have lost, but what we gained by having them here on earth and having an opportunity to love them and an opportunity for them to love us. So when I hear the words, "Our loss is heaven's gain," I tend to like to flip that a little bit, because it definitely is our loss, but it is the saints' gain. The saints gain heaven. John 14:2-3 says, "In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would have told you. And if I go to prepare a place, I will come again and take you to be where I am." So we know that this place is a wondrous place, nothing that we can add to or take away from, because it is God's home. It is a home prepared for us and waiting for the saints. We always think about the loss and remember the gain here on earth. We love our lost ones. We mourn them. We remember them, all the great stories that they may have told us and the way that they lived their lives. So now I would like for you to join me, not just in reading these names, but remembering the very essence of the life that this name represents. Laura Barnes, October 12, 2019. Bill Wheeler, January 8, 2020. Susie Taylor, February 5, 2020. C.B. Bass, March 1, 2020. Leo Bass, March 23, 2020. Geraldine Lamb, April 20, 2020. McCray Boyette, April 30th, 2020. Willis Holland, June 15th, 2020. Leon Johnson, September 2020. These saints have gained heaven. So what gain is that? If we read in Revelations, especially Revelations 21, we are told that God will wipe away every tear. There will be no more pain, no more death, no more darkness, because God is the light. That is what they have gained. They also have gained a wondrous home. I know how we all love our homes here and how we love our home church. And sometimes there's nothing like going home. But think about a place that has been prepared for the saints. A place that the Bible tells us is a wondrous place. Think about 1 Corinthians 2:9. It is written, "I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for those who love him." It's beyond our human capacity to understand heaven. But we have the faith and we have that hope that that is where our home will be when this earthly home is no more. But most of all, what these saints gain and what all Christians will gain is an eternal, joyous reunion with God in God's house, in God's house. I read a book many years ago. It was by Billy Graham, and it was called Where I Am: Heaven, Eternity, and Life Beyond. One of the quotes in this book says, "One day you will hear or read that Billy Graham is dead. Don't believe a word of it. I will be more alive there than I was here. I will have just changed my address. I will have gone into the very presence of God." So we remember our loved ones today. We honor them, and we thank them for the lessons that they left with us in this life. Yes, we feel the loss and wish that we could hug them one more time or have them make us one more good cup of coffee or to see a gracious smile of a lovely lady as she walks down the church aisle, to enjoy food that only their hands know how to prepare. to hear them call our name or maybe our nicknames that we were so fond of hearing. Maybe we would love to be encouraged one more time by the way they could. And we would love to witness that bravery and courage that they had during this earthly walk. But we remember the gain, and we hold dear the gain of the wisdom by being in their presence, their strong work ethic, their ability to love their family, their community, and their church, all the lessons they have taught us. We remember the gain of having them in our life, of knowing them, loving them, and having them love us. So as Christians here on this earth, we must also carry on and walk by faith, knowing that one day we too will leave this earthly existence and step into the wonder of heaven where God lives. I would like to close this part of the service with an old hymn that's called When We All Get to Heaven. You all know it. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, and we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all sing Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Please let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for these saints who have crossed the threshold into your wonderful home, the home where you live. We pray for those Christians that remain here on earth to walk by faith, knowing that one day our turn too will come to cross that threshold. We thank you for what they represented to us in life, and we pray that we can continue that witness as we continue to live our lives here on earth. We thank you for every blessing, and we give you all the glory, and thank you for your many, many blessings in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for Ms. Kay. Beautiful job and words well spoken in celebration of each and every one of these lives. We now move into our time of observation of the Lord's Supper. I hope that as you arrived that you did receive one of our prepackaged communion kits, that you've been able to separate the film and the foil without any issues. And this goes not only for those who are physically present in this sanctuary, but also to those who are viewing via the web stream. I hope that you've made preparations with some bread and juice or whatever may be convenient for you this morning. I've talked with a few of you in recent weeks, and it's interesting what you had available to celebrate the Lord's Supper. But regardless of what you may have or don't have, when you do it with a reverent heart, know that God is there in your midst. Know that God is still willing to meet you through those elements. What a wonderful time it is to share in the bread and the cup. I know the last 6 months have certainly altered the ways, the frequency, and so forth of us being able to remember the sacrifice that was given for us at Calvary. But it's good to be here today on this homecoming Sunday. And as we move into this time of worship, we'll confess, we'll affirm, and then we'll bless and celebrate this meal together. May our hearts and our minds be open to this time and receptive to the Word of God through these elements.
Please join with me in the prayer of confession. Let us pray.
God of love,
who has made our hearts restless until they find their rest in you, we come expressing gratitude for the gift of our freedom through Christ. It is a precious gift which empties us of selfish ambitions, personal pride, and broken intentions, and restores us to the divine image in which we are created. Forgive us of our shortcomings, both of commission and omission, and help us to so live your love among others that they may see your love in us and enter into a faithful relationship with you. Amen. And now our affirmation of faith, also in unison. Please join me. We believe there is one living, true, and eternal God, the Father, in whom are all things, from everlasting to everlasting, glorious and unchangeable in all his attributes. We believe there is one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, the only Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary, who was truly God and truly human. We believe there is one Holy Spirit, the precious gift of the Father through his Son, who is the divine presence in our lives. We believe that the church is the body of Christ, all believers everywhere. We believe in the general provision made of God in Christ for all who respond in total trust and commitment. We believe in the fellowship of the saints through the worshiping community and in the promise of life eternal. Amen.
The scriptures teach us that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with the disciples in an upper room to share the Passover Seder meal. And during the course of that meal, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat, for this represents my body, which is broken for you." And in like manner, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it also to the 12 and said, "Take this cup, divide it among you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, my blood which is poured out for the forgiveness of all sin." And in those beautiful words from the Apostle Paul to the Christians at Corinth, "As often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we remember, we celebrate, we proclaim our Lord's death, burial, and resurrection until he comes again one day." Would you bow with me for prayer? Lord, how do we even begin to say thank you for the love, the mercy, the grace that we experience at Calvary? We know that we are a fallen people. And even as a people of faith, we stumble from time to time in this journey. But Lord, we have confessed our sins. And your word reminds us that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just and will forgive us and cleanse us from our unrighteousness. Lord, we have affirmed our core values and beliefs as a faith community. And now we come together in person via this web stream, knowing that wherever we are assembled, that you promise to be in our midst. Lord, we ask that you would bless this bread and this cup, that they will be not just things, not just one aspect of this worship service, but that they may truly be reminders of the fellowship we have with our sisters and brothers in Christ and the grateful spirits that we should each and every one have for what you have done for each of us. Lord, bless this bread and cup, those who receive it. Meet us in this moment and remind us of what you have done and what we are to proclaim as we go forth into the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jesus said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Jesus said, "Take and drink. This is my blood, which is shed for you." Thanks be unto God. Amen and amen. At this time, our children are dismissed for their junior church and children's church next door with Miss Marcy in Heritage Hall.
And Miss Ashley.
David, I'm not sure how far back we go. I remember there was a time as I was finishing high school that you came to be the interim pastor at Reedy Branch.
That's right.
Little did I know around that time that God was going to be calling me into full-time vocational ministry and that I would go on and be one of your students.
God bless you.
At the University of Mount Olive, then Mount Olive College. Taking Greek, life and teachings of Jesus, congregational leadership, and I still hold on to a lot of those things.
Thank you.
Even though those classes have been probably 16, 18 years ago, some of them. But we are greatly blessed to have the Reverend Dr. David Hines with us to bring God's Word to us in this time of homecoming. I consider him not only a colleague, a former professor, an advisor, I truly consider David to be a friend. And it's still hard to call you David instead of Dr. Hines. And there are times I still slip up and call you Dr. Hines, but I know he has a faithful word that God's Spirit has placed upon his heart for this day. And so I'm going to step out of the way and allow God to use you, David. We are grateful that you have chosen the Scripture and to impart it faithfully to us.
Thank you, Callie. God bless.
Absolutely.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is a joy to be back in Little Rock Church and to be able to share with you this morning. Kelly, we do go way back, and actually with your family goes way back before that time at Reedy Branch Church. But I live in a germ factory called a university with a thousand of my best friends between 18 and 20 years old. So I'm very used to wearing a mask, but I think I've got a good 12 feet between me and the front row. So if I may, I think that would be okay. But I am, I'm a faithful masker, and because I care about you. What? I'm not a spitter either. I'm going to try not to spray the front row. I imagine that most of you who've been a part of Little Rock Church for several years are very familiar with a dear, dear friend of mine, Jean Akis. I can imagine Jean Akis with all the work she's done with the Mount Olive College and then University of Mount Olive County dinners back in the day, and all the people she's encouraged to be bridge builders, and here I am preaching a sermon entitled Burning Bridges. She could have heart failure right here in front of us. And I do believe in building bridges. In fact, 5 years ago when I moved into my current work at the university, we adopted as a motto in our office to build bridges, not barriers. To make education is hard work, but let's don't build artificial obstacles into this. So let's build bridges, not barriers. And often it is good advice. Don't burn your bridges. It reminds me, at least, that sometimes it's best not to say my piece. I've heard people say, "Well, if I think it, I may as well say it." Brothers and sisters, no. We do not have to say everything we think. thanks be to God. We don't have to do that. Because I can remember a couple of times that I did, and I can remember having a long time having to live with the fact that I said what was on my mind. But in just a few moments, we're going to take our text today from 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning at verse 19, and we'll ask that question, is there a time when it is necessary for people of faith to burn a bridge? Is there a time for that? And I submit to you that sometimes there is. So from 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning with verse 19, I invite you to listen for the word of God. So he, this is Elijah, departed from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yokes of oxen before him. And he was with the 12. Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you. And he said to him, go back again, for what have I done to you? And he returned from following him and took the yoke of oxen. Elisha took the yoke of oxen and slew them, and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen, and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah, who ministered to him. Inspired by the Spirit of God, my brothers and sisters, this is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Merciful God, we call upon your name, asking that you would give us clarity of thought and wisdom. We thank you for your word written for our instruction, our edification. And we pray now that you would use this word through the power of your Holy Spirit to continue to form us and to shape us so that we more perfectly resemble your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. For it is in his dear name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So the prophet Elijah was reaching the end of his physical ministry. He was reaching that end. And now think about it. How would you like to follow Elijah? I mean, really? We're talking about someone who confronts the prophets of Baal at Mount Carmel. And by the way, Mount Carmel was kind of like the Baal home site. It'd be like taking on Duke at Cameron. It's there, and I specifically chose the Duke Blue Devils to give that illustration of Mount Carmel on their home site. Okay, I won't enter into an argument today, I promise, about that. But you get my point. That was their hometown. That was their home sanctuary. And that we had that great contest, and the God answers by fire, whether it be the Baals or whether it be the Lord. And then when the Baal prophets just went crazy, nothing happened except their craziness. And then Elijah prayed a very simple prayer. In effect, said, Lord, show the people who you are. Fire came down from heaven and lit up an altar full of wet wood. And the people cried out at the top of their lungs, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. Now, I don't do foreign language lessons in the pulpit often. But you know how you would say the Lord, he is God in Hebrew? Elijah, 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 because his name means the Lord, he is God. So, you would think this great prophet would be just walking on mountains, and no, next few days he had a mad woman after him and he run like a stuck pig. He surely did. But in that day when he run like a stuck pig and he finally went in that cave and sought the Lord, and when he finally heard from the Lord, it was in the sound of a still small voice. And the Lord gave him another job to do. He said, it's time for you to find someone who's going to come on behind you. And so here is Elijah laying the prophet's mantle on the one who would follow him, Elisha. And now he goes, he gives his goodbyes, if you will, to his mother and father. And then what does he do? Now, you see, in the field plowing, and there were 12 different yokes of oxen, and he was in the last one. Now, if you know anything about agriculture, this was the guy that had an eight-wheel drive tractor as wide as this sanctuary plowing the field. That's what it would be the equivalent of in that day. It's 12 yokes of oxen, and Elisha was at the back. But what did he do? He killed his oxen. He took the harnesses and burned them, and that's how he built, that's how he boiled the flesh to, and give out the meat. Yes, he was giving out to others, but what was he doing? He was cutting his tie to his past. And when he killed those oxen, and when he started that fire, and when he boiled that meat, he was saying in the words of the hymn that many of us learned when we were little children, "No turning back. No turning back." Well, David, that's a neat story. What in the world would that have to do with Little Rock Church on Homecoming Sunday? As you folks remember, 149 years of ministry in this community. Yes, I went on the website and read a little of your history. It's a goodly history, too, at that. And then to walk through the Hall of Fame out there in that hallway there, and to see that list of ministers, and knowing the impact that those ministers have made in this Free Will Baptist Convention and continue to make. Wow, what a goodly heritage you have. And incidentally, please, please, please do remember Frank Harrison. My heart just breaks for what he is going through right now. His second wife, he's lost to cancer. And my brother Frank has had more than his fair share of pain and grief. I'm not going to charge you any extra for this. This has nothing to do with my sermon, but it has a whole lot to do with what faith looks like. Many of you remember it wasn't too long ago when his son Chris was killed in that Duke helicopter accident. And I was given the honor of singing with three individuals at that funeral. And we were asked to sing the song Victory in Jesus. And as long as I live, I will never, ever forget Frank sitting from where I was singing to be about right where I was sitting before I came up to preach. And we're singing Victory in Jesus. And there's Frank clapping his hands like this and singing with us. Brothers and sisters, that's what faith looks like. That's faith that's real. That is faith that's real. This church has known hard times. It's known good times. But I look at Little Rock Church, and I look at a church with a goodly heritage. Hundreds of people have come to know Christ because of the ministry of the people of this church. This community and our denomination has been enriched because this church has committed itself to be of service to Jesus Christ. So it's a church with a goodly heritage. It's a church that's been creative in responding to challenges. Even now, as we're living through times like I have never experienced in my life, there is nowhere in my pastor's guides a chapter entitled Responding to a Pandemic. And I got news for you. There is nothing in anything I've ever read or done at a university that says how to organize academic affairs during a time of a pandemic. I feel like a quarterback of a football team that's calling an audible on every play. Like, oh, let me read the defense. Okay, we're going to run this play this time. And it's hard, it's stressful, and we're all dealing with it. We're dealing with this sense of isolation. And I'm not good at isolation. I don't do that very well. I'm an extrovert. I like people. I like hugs. I like the handshakes. I like looking people in the eye. All those things have just been a challenge to us. Yet we continue to find ways, including right now, knowing that there's people watching us from their homes right now. It's not the preferred way, but it is a way. So we're creative as we respond to challenges. This heritage, though, cannot be a harness holding us back to the way things have always been done. In fact, I think our heritage should become the launch pad for us to embrace new challenges, new ministries, new growth. George Bernard Shaw once said, and I love this quote, "Some look at things the way they are and they say, why? I dream of things that have never been and say, why not?" Brothers and sisters, the mantle has been cast on us. The mantle's been cast on us. What are we going to do with it? We learn from our past, but now moving forward into unprecedented times, what are we going to do? I submit that we must be free. We must be free. We must be free to dream, free to work, free to grow. But by free, I mean focused on Christ, responsive to needs, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and equipped to serve. If we're going to be free, we must first and foremost be focused on Christ. Jesus Christ is the head of our church. It is Jesus Christ who gives us our vision. It's Jesus Christ who gives us our direction. I think it's interesting that before the believers in Jesus were ever called Christians, they were called the people of the way. Now think about that text in John where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father but by me. I think we only hear half of what that text says most of the time because we tend to focus on that text is that Jesus Christ, in his death and his resurrection, he provided the atoning sacrifice. He provided the way that all of us can experience eternal life. Amen. That is what that text says. I agree. But that's not all it says. Jesus said, I am the way. And when Jesus called his disciples, what did he call them to do? Follow me. This way. Pay attention. This way now. Follow in the way of Jesus. That's what it means to be focused on Christ. We are the followers of Jesus, and we've got to find out what it looks like and what it feels like to resemble Jesus in action and attitude. And I don't know about you, but that's a challenge I live with every day of my life. When Paul was talking to the Corinthians, he focused on two ideas, knowing Christ and making him known. And his every action was measured by how it would help move him to that goal. And that becomes the direction for our church even today. It is easy for church to fall into the pattern of just sustaining an operation, just like we're managing a business. Church is more than that. It's a living thing. It's alive. And sometimes it's messy. Sometimes it doesn't get managed very well. And that's okay. Representing Christ, knowing Christ, making him known, focused on Christ. The mantle's been thrust upon us. We must move forward. And focusing on Christ, the next thing that's going to happen is very natural, is being responsive to human needs. I've had the opportunity to think a lot recently, trying to reimagine what our university should look like as a university in the tradition of original Free Will Baptist. But to do that, I had to go back and think more about what it means to be a Free Will Baptist. What are those things that have defined us historically? Very simply, as we affirmed in our affirmation today, we affirmed in the general provision made of Christ for all who respond in total trust and commitment. When Jesus died on the cross, he died for all humankind. No one will ever be born for want of a Savior. All can come to know Christ. Jesus died for all. Now, that's a core value. That was one of the very basic principles that we, people who came to be known as Free Will Baptists, confessed. But that's not all. We actually affirm freedom of religion a long time before Jefferson ever talked about it, because we believe that any faith that's compelled isn't faith. That we all respond freely. That's a part of our heritage from the very beginning. Not only that, when we were persecuted, we ended up going over to Amsterdam, where we came under the influence of the Mennonites, and that's where we picked up the tradition, the washing of the saints' feet. If the original Free Will Baptist Church is going to have a future that's meaningful, it's going to be because we learned to wash feet. I'm not just talking about the ordinance. I'm talking about being a people who live in service. We respond to the needs of people. If the ultimate goal of a congregation is to build a bigger congregation, I see no grace in that, and that's not our job. Our job is to serve. Our job is to meet people's needs. But here's the good part. If we faithfully serve, if we care for the hurting, if we love the lonely, if we show grace to the troubled, God will give the increase. Paul said, I planted, Apollos watered, but my brilliance gave the growth. That's not what he said, is it? My successful planning gave the growth? Nope, didn't say that either. Nope. But God gave the growth, so neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. We serve. God builds. If we're going to serve, we can't do that by ourselves. We don't have the strength. So how are we going to do it? We must be empowered by the Holy Spirit. Now, in what strikes me as a very bizarre, I mean a really strange text, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the first part of verse 7, Paul tells that church at Corinth that they were not lacking in any spiritual gift. Now, I take comfort in that because the Corinthian church was pretty messed up, folks. In fact, I've referred to the church at Corinth as the first Free Will Baptist church because they found thing after thing that they could argue about and get ticked off with each other about. But to this group of mixed up, messed up people who really got into this thing about abusing the idea of spiritual gifts, Paul says right from the get-go that you're not lacking in any spiritual gift. Folks, if it was true of Corinth, it's true of Little Rock. This church is not lacking in any spiritual gift that's needed to advance the ministry of Christ in this community. It's here. The Holy Spirit is not for our personal glory. The Holy Spirit is not even there to make us feel good. Because faith isn't a feeling, faith is following. But the Holy Spirit is there to empower us to do what God wants done. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. There is a wealth of talent and resources in this community. The only thing that limits it is our willingness to set those gifts loose for God's glory. You know, in Elijah's time, the belief was that the Spirit of God only fell on a certain individual to do a certain task. Now, Joel looked forward to the day when there'd be a universal outpouring of God's Spirit on all flesh. Sons and daughters shall prophesy. Young men, young women, young and old, like God's Spirit was going to fall on them. And that miracle was achieved at Pentecost, and we live in Pentecost. We live post-Pentecost. God's Spirit falls on every believer. It's up to us to yield. And then equipped to serve. When churches call a minister to be a part of a church family, they call that minister to serve and to lead. But I got a surprise for you. You haven't called your ministers, you haven't called your pastors to minister for you. You've not called them to do your ministry for you. It stands true that your baptism is your ordination. All of us are called to ministry. I've heard people say that, well, you know, you have been called to be a minister, a preacher, that's the highest calling. I don't believe that, not one bit. It's the calling that God placed on my life. That doesn't make me any better than anyone else. Your highest calling is what God's called you to do. And the ground at the cross is level. There's no hierarchy in God's kingdom. No hierarchy. We're all called to serve. But then what is that role of those ministers? Help you learn how to minister. Equipping the saints for the work of ministry. And a lot of times the best way to teach it is to show it. Now, I get that. But it's our job. All of us are called to be priests, but it's our job to help you to discover your gifts, to discover the ministry opportunities in your life, and help you find a way to do them more effectively. There was a dear, dear friend of mine back when I was at Free Union Church in Greene County. And this gentleman lost his wife unexpectedly. I remember being with him and talking with him, and in fact was with him when they talked to the physicians about removing the life support. And then waiting with that gentleman all day long as we simply waited for his wife to die. I remember all of us in that room holding hands, and as I recited Psalm 121 as she made her last journey from this life to the next. I'll lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord who made heaven and earth. We Free Will Baptists call that the Cragmont Psalm, but it's bigger than that. And then the part that I remember most about this gentleman was about 3 months later. He was one of the deacons. He began to mobilize the deacon board. And Monday, Wednesdays, and Friday mornings, he with a couple of his buddies would go out and start visiting. They'd go to the hospital if we had anybody in the hospital, and then they'd visit the rest homes. And they just continued to share in that time of ministry to people, ministry to the sick and the hurting, the lonely in the community. And I remember speaking to him a little later. It was coming that time we needed to elect a new chairperson for the deacons. And I spoke to him and said, you know, people asking if you'd be the chairman. Well, he said, David, I don't know how to lead a deacon's meeting. And I called him. I said, Mike, his wasn't name, but I just make up a name. I said, Mike, in the dictionary beside the word deacon, they have your picture. You're going to lead this group by showing them how it's done. That's what we're doing, brothers and sisters. We show each other together what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus. And it's not what we say that marks the follower. The follower is one that's walking in a clear direction with Christ as the leader. And when you're looking ahead, you know what that means? There's no turning back. There's no turning back. Brothers and sisters, would you join me today in being free, being focused on Christ, being responsive to human need, being empowered by God's Spirit, and being equipped to serve? That journey, folks, is worth a life. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for your word and the guidance that it provides us. And we thank you for the opportunity of hearing that word. Now, Lord, help us to become more than listeners. Help us to be the followers you've called us and challenged us to be. Father, may your grace, may your peace, may your power rest upon this church, its pastors, and this entire community of faith. Use them in a mighty way, O Lord, to show, to demonstrate, to live the good news of Jesus Christ. Father, may those of us who are on our way to heaven start living the life of heaven right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn of commitment is very appropriately, Jesus is Lord of all. We invite you to stand as we sing together. Brother Kelly.
This altar is open. No matter the needs that are close to your heart, no matter the condition of your heart, the hurts, the challenges that you're facing this week, if you've never accepted Christ and made him your personal Lord and Savior, will you come? Perhaps you would like to come and make a recommitment to Christ and following the way that he would have you to go in without turning back. Perhaps there are needs, perhaps there are even thanksgivings that are close to your heart. This altar is open as we sing together, Jesus is Lord of all. Brothers and sisters, it's been good to be with you in the house of our Lord and Savior this day. David, thank you for that word, a very appropriate word for the living of these challenging times, reminding us that we each have a calling, even in the midst of such trials and tribulations. David, I'm going to invite you to join me in the narthex. I'm going to scoot back and grab my mask, but I'm going to let David go ahead to the narthex. I know you'll want to extend an elbow or fist bump of appreciation. I would say right hand of fellowship, but we are thankful. And certainly I'm used to blessing the meal now, but we know circumstances are a little bit different this year with homecoming. But thank you for being here, those in person, those viewing the web stream. We ask God's very best of blessings to be upon you all as we minister in the week to come. Would you bow to receive our benediction and the blessing of this week's offering? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of this day, this season of worship, for the rich history and heritage of Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church, and for all the things that we have been able to do, but Lord, for the work that continues to exist before us. Lord, give us strength, give us courage, give us boldness as we seek to go out and to follow your leadership, your lordship, and to be who the church is called to be in the community around us. Lord, we ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings that have been sent in, those we'll receive at the door, that you may multiply them and use them for the ongoing work of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.